quiz here, right?
What is the common theme across these faces that you see on the slide? All are men. That's a good start.
Let's profile them a little bit. What else? What are the commonalities?
Startup founders.
Yes.
Men startup founders.
Unique thinkers.
Unicorns. And not everything is a unicorn yet.
Indians, yes.
Wow.
What else?
All digital, all related to online, all right? All Indians, all rich.
Something more about people.
Their
who are they?
Where they come from. Actually, about only half of them are from Bangalore.
No? Not all. Actually, maybe just two or three.
It's very interesting you bring IIT, because we'll come to that in a minute, right? Notice how we are profiling in our head already. Right? These guys are successful, must be from IIT.
So let's summarize. Men, young, Indian startup owners.
All VC funded. Yeah. Actually, everybody, unfortunately. We should have put Bhavin Turakia here to make an exception.
Indian, yes. Now we are talking.
North Indian, who said that? That's a brilliant observation. All of these guys, if you notice where they come from, right? Pretty much everyone is a Baniya community. Right? You were about to say, but you thought it might not be a nice term to use. But that's the reality, right? All of these guys come from, in India we call them Baniya community, which is a business community. Right? So, oops, we lost the pretty pictures. So now I want to do a quick exercise. I want you to go to the left of the room. If you believe you can be one of those founders in the next 5 years, I want you to get up and come to the left of the room. Your right. And if you believe that this is not something that you want to do, or you're not interested, you don't stand a chance, then let's come to the right of the room, or left to the room. And if you are in doubt, maybe, then sit wherever you are. Actually, come to the middle. Let's get some energy, right? Let's move. It'll help us with some energy.
Yes, so get up, everybody.
Thank you to cooperate. Let's just quickly do this exercise. In the middle is folks who are not sure. On this side are folks who don't think or are not interested, all right? And then folks who are here believe that they would like to be or would see themselves on that in the next 5 years or 10 years. Doesn't matter. Five is enough. Five, okay. We'll stick with five. Is everyone done? I still see people making up their mind.
Any second thoughts?
Tossing
you want to reorganize?
Okay. Any observations from the distribution that you see here? Age group?
Group is bigger, yes, but again, little deeper. What else?
One interesting observation is certainly age group on this side. Any other observations? people who have some kind of loans or things better be on that side. Very interesting level of profiling going on. let's see here. What do you see here? Any special observations?
Yes.
Notice a lot of them over there have specs, so that must be the secret sauce. Eagerly waiting for funding. That's a very good observation.
Yes.
Only three women here, but a lot more women in the other groups.
What about people in the center here? Why couldn't you make up your mind? Why?
Happy with the job, so in transition. Want to be here, but if it was 10 years, maybe you would put yourself over there. That's cool. Thank you. Please take a seat, and we want to make a point about this exercise. Let's look at one other example before we jump into a little bit more theory or science behind some of the thinking process that goes on.
Okay, so here is again a profile of a sports person, and we are going to look at some of the achievements of this person. Mind-blowing achievements. Who could this be? Thank you, Vishal. So yes, so this was a much better example to get the point across. So you were all part of this experiment today, right? So, Federer and Serena Williams, for example, right? Same age, 36-year-old this year, right? And Federer got his 20th Grand Slam, but Serena already had crossed 20. She had 23. So, what was playing in everybody's mind when you categorically said that it has to be Federer?
I thought she was always 16. But... that's
you had this big context set of Women's Day. Still, you all said Federer. Why? Sorry? Is there something that you particularly associated or expected to happen here? Any thoughts on that? Is sportsmanship, achievements, is that something that you assume some people to do more than the others? I want to hear from you guys.
Something like sports is generally associated with men, and it immediately comes to mind, it can't be a woman, you know, just because it's sports.
Bringing that up, but you know, it's more of reflection time for all of us, right? Like immediate response, what happens, and then maybe we think about it a little bit more.
So you responded first, and then you are rationalizing your response. I'm using Linda's workshop details here. So you already did something in your mind very quickly, maybe subconsciously, and you answered. And now that you have to explain your answer, you're using some logic, right? But what is probably going on in your mind or went on in your mind is this notion of cognitive schemas, okay? So what is a cognitive schema? We are going to get a little bit technical here. So please bear with me for a couple of minutes, okay? So a schema is some construct that you have formed in your mind, right? So what you are taking into consideration is attributes, characteristics, and it's getting processed and converted into expectations, perceptions, behaviors, right? And attitudes, most importantly, the attitudes, right? Now, what are some more examples of these schemas that you guys can think of? I have some examples here about Generation X or myths about gay or LGBT population. So, can you guys take a minute and, you know, think about what are schemas that you already might be subconsciously operating by?
Yeah, so it's a quick exercise. We want you to think about some of these schemas that you may have in your mind. And then what we would like is, once you think about it, turn to the person next to you and share that, if you don't mind.
Just 1 minute exercise. Let's do it quickly.
Yes. Think about it, deep solo thinking, and then share it with the person next to you. It shouldn't be very hard because some of these are there.
Just have to dig them out.
So we've given three examples of, you know, kind of things that we operate in our head. And so what we want is to think about one of those examples, like those three, and then share it with the person next to you. Not these three, like something else that you operate on. Like why in a lot of Indian ads, for example, when you see, if it's an ad about, you know, something household, it's always a woman in the ad. Right? There's something going on in there.
So any interesting insights there? Who would like to summarize what was discussed? Yes?
If you don't mind, can you not be a backbencher and come here?
All enterprises are very slow in, they are laggards in agile adoption, and startups are very quick. So that's one of the biases that...
I have the bias that all the ad industry that is there in general, they look up to women as an object rather than treating them as human beings. As recently, one of the examples that I could see when is the Swiggy ad. There are three ads that come. Generally, I don't watch TV and I come from work. So I was watching the Swiggy ad. The one ad is... there is a Sardar Singh guy who is waiting, all the friends are watching a match, and then there's a delivery happening. That's one ad. Then there's another ad where parents are out of town, and there's the only girl alone, and she just pulls over her shirt like this. So she's only home alone. So what's the message that Swiggy is trying to deliver? You know, when the boys, they're showing the boys as a group of boys watching a match, whereas there's a message very clearly saying that parents are out of town and girl is alone. So this is an ad industry. When you look at the way they portray women, typically whenever I see an ad, it means, okay, I don't buy such products or even look at them.
That's a good example. What we are trying to get to here, although, is what is happening inside us, right? So we need to dig a little deeper into how is our decision making or behavior or thoughts in our mind when we are across in a situation. What is going on in our mind at most personal level? Okay, and why are we even talking about this, right? Any guesses? It's Women's Day, Naresh introduced inclusion, and why are we talking about this? Again, I'm going to go back to the talks that I have attended in the conference. Linda is here. Yeah, so our behavior is controlled by our biases. That's what I learned from her session. I also picked up a line from Alan Cooper's presentation. He said, softwares are easy to change, but minds are not, right? And on this day, we want to broaden our perspective. We don't want to do anything ceremonial, but we want our agile teams to succeed with the true feeling of inclusion and victory. What I mean by that, if I'm not bringing myself, whole self to work, or I'm not being myself at work, it is going to affect, have an effect on the way I'm working and the quality of software I'm getting out of the door at the end of the day. So that's the reason we are talking about. There are lots of things that the governments can do and the organizations can do, but what is it that you are willing to do as an individual who is part of a team, a group of people? So go down to that level, think of what's going on in your mind. Have you come across a situation? Let's again take an example. Quick comments on all these three images. What do you see? Anything unusual? And be honest now, we have set the context, so don't try to be a good boy or a good girl. Anything unusual? Yeah. So when you don't expect a man to take care of a baby, then if you were to see something like that, you know, how would you respond to that? What is the thought that is going on in your mind? Any examples, anything that rings a bell here?
He is neither happy taking care of kid or actually doing the work. So that's what is.
Why you think he's not happy taking care of the kid?
By looking into his face.
Sorry?
By looking into his face, it's very evident. So he is not happy at all.
So is it something that men don't enjoy doing or not made or cut out for?
I'm a man and I enjoy it. But
yeah.
From this
the
picture,
image.
Yeah.
Okay.
From this picture,
it doesn't look like. So what could be the reason for that?
You could be looking at crappy code, for example.
Yeah, or an escalation email.
Or it could be a social media also, who knows.
Maybe he doesn't want the kid to look at the crappy code. There's something going on here, so.
Okay, so we are going to again try to explain some of these things. Maybe give you a model to kind of map some of the things even more if possible, right? So going back to the theory of social categorization, again, I won't talk this language for more than a minute, I promise. So what really happens is we have this notion of groups and we want to be associated and recognized as being a part of a group, right? So I belong to a particular group called X. The group has some characteristics, has some clear attributes, A, B, C. So I, as a member of that group, is always going to believe because I'm a part of that group, I'm going to inherit and internalize all the qualities of that group, right? And that is what is going to, I'm going to get programmed to do things that way. So that's what this set of boxes on the down corner here are showing us. As against the left side again, so if some person belongs to group X, right, and the group X has these characteristics, I'm going to assume that, oh, for example, okay, no offense here, just using examples, right? If somebody belongs to Delhi, right, I'm going to say, oh, all Delhiites are loud, they love to have fun, right? So maybe this guy falls in that category too. Doesn't that happen subconsciously in our minds? Always, right? So we want you to go down to that level, that depth, and think about it. Any situation, any experience that you willingly or unwillingly brought to work, right? And maybe there was something that you did or some thought that crossed your mind and you think, maybe I shouldn't have done it that way. Maybe it is a completely subconscious thing that you didn't even realize in that moment. Is there something that you want to, you know, think about a minute to take?
I have a question here. These thoughts do come naturally. Humans, as humans, we are judgmental to different degrees. A person who
first thing to ask ourselves is it really wrong to be judgmental? Cameraman, why are you asking questions?
Because cameraman also thinks a little bit.
Just trying to demonstrate something. We've had this experience at this very conference a few times when someone who's a volunteer manning the camera started asking a question, and people are like, hey, cameraman, don't ask questions. Like, why cameramen cannot be technical? I was just trying to demonstrate something, but sorry, go ahead.
The first question to ask ourselves is it really wrong fundamentally? I mean, if that is a natural thought that has come, should I really be having a guilt for having that thought? That's something to be looked at.
We'll come to that. We just give 2 minutes. I'll make a point and answer your question. Okay. So us and them, who's not familiar with this, right? Again, lots of examples. A wise friend helped me come up with this example. Employees and consultants, right? Yeah? Maybe Naresh has a lot of experience in defining attributes of employees and consultants.
Do you guys have in your mind, when you come to know that someone is an employee versus someone is a consultant, suddenly do you see a switch in your head go off and you treat people slightly differently? Has it ever happened? Policies are like that. Yeah, we can always find something to blame, that's for sure. But I at least as in my career, I've seen that distinct moments when people switch, when they come to know that, oh, you're not an employee, you're a consultant, then suddenly what you're saying either will make sense or completely not make sense. But, you know, there's a switch the moment people realize something of you. So there's this inherent profiling that has already happened. They've kind of built a schema in their head, and you kind of fit into a particular schema, so it's now a different experience or different feeling from you.
There's also a feeling of jealousy towards consultants.
That's unfortunately
that,
there.
That guy earns more than me.
Yeah. So again, that goes back to the previous example of we think consultants have attribute A, B, and C, and then if you see someone demonstrating A, B, and C, then that must be a consultant, right? A lot of times I have gone to companies and I'm usually in my uniform of shorts, and people come down and they, you know, they're looking for me, and then they just walk away because they don't see me at all, right? This guy is a consultant, cannot be in shorts, right? They expect someone in a blazer, they expect someone to be very tight, shaved, clean, right? And I don't fit the profile, so they just go back and they say, we looked for you, but you were not there. So, happens, real world examples. So again, we are not specifically, we're talking about inclusion in general and the kind of thought processes that we go through.
Okay, so now this is where we are going to try to tie everything together, Vishal. So we introduced the concept of cognitive schemas. There is some model in your head, right? And there is also a model of social categorization, right? When things shift from my personal opinions to my social expression of that opinion, what happens is what we are going to try to explain now, right? So personal identity is important. Social identity gives us some meaning, purpose, and probably answers the question, who am I? What are the things that the values that I'm supposed to live by, the beliefs that I'm supposed to inherit? So social identity is extremely important, right? But what happens when you have a very, very strong identification or investment in a social identity is you start marking territories, right? The boundaries, right? So, socially what goes on is there is a feeling of in-group, membership to the group, and being away from group. I cannot identify with that group, right? And as a natural extension of this, right? So the in-group members enjoy a higher status of power, right? Safety, dominance, authority, prestige, right? There is a sense of superiority. And the group on the other side obviously feels, I do not belong to that powerful group. I don't belong to that dominated group. Hence, I do not feel safe. I feel powerless, basically. I don't feel I have a say here, right? So that is what happens, right? So, Vishal, to answer your question, it's not wrong to feel that way, but how do you express that feeling when you are in a group? That is what we are talking about, essentially, right?
And the impact it has because of that, right? So it may not be wrong because it intuitively kicks in, but how you express it and how what impact it would have, reaction to that is important.
So we had some videos playing on outside. I don't know if you guys had the time to go through some of the slides there. So we record.
I was telling Prachi that was a failed experiment.
It was. I agree.
I was sitting like a lot of time outside. I hardly saw like 4 or 5.
I saw all the people having their backs at the screen and blocking it or not interested. So yes, we take that as a feedback, indirect feedback, and we will work on that. Okay. So the.
Because there were no other screens there, so there was, yeah, there were a few more, but that was a little bit more successful than the one here, but I still think if we see a quick show of hands, how many people watched the whole thing?
Whole thing was 10 to 12 minutes, so thank you if you watched the whole thing.
Again, not trying to blame anyone, it's just we are saying it's a feedback for us that this experiment was tried where we thought instead of bringing all of that here, let's let it be kind of self-consumable, but we realized that it was maybe not the best way to do it. Anyway.
Yeah, so I'm going to take a couple of examples from the slides which were put outside, and at the end of these 2 minutes, I am going to make you guys talk and share your experiences. I think I'm talking too much. So there was an...
But don't all women talk too much?
Okay, so there is an oncologist friend of mine. He is an LGBT activist. He has shared his experience about this, that he's still not married. Obviously, we live in India. So people used to ask him all the time at work that you're 40, not married yet? What's wrong? Anything wrong with you? When are you going to get married? You know, kuch chal raha hai kya? You know, all kinds of things.
I'd like to draw your attention to, obviously we live in India. That is a bias there.
Okay, so first thing, when I personally started researching this subject, I found that gender sensitization, all the issues that we talk about, discrimination, inclusion, these are global phenomenon. The degree of things might be changing depending on the geography, but this is a global phenomenon. So that's one thing that, you know, we don't have to feel bad about, that we have it only because we live here. That's again a bias. Yeah, you probably would give some space to the person. So anyway, so that's one, that kind of was tearing the person apart, and the person could not bring his whole self to work. And when he came out, he felt that he could contribute much more positively to work. There is another slide there. There is a blind girl who lives in Bangalore. She turned blind 8 years back, right? And the kind of things that she used to experience at work, that some people are pointing to objects probably which she can't see. She felt left out of conversations all the time, right? And these are still examples of something very, very obvious. We are talking about different diversity categories. But there is a lot going on in our mind at such a subtle level that we don't even realize it, right? So there are certain examples here. One more story there of Jim Turley, who was a CEO in Ernst & Young. So he was holding a meeting to take some strategic decisions. And they had a good ratio of women and men on their team. And he always wants to seek a buy-in from his team, right? So there were three women in his team who were trying to make a point, right? They repetitively said something and he did not respond to that. There was a man who said something, same observation, completely in line with what these three ladies said. And then he said, Jim, I think you're right. So, but he was nice to admit it, accept it and reflect on it, right? It was nice of him to have realized that. So when these three women approached him and said that we know you didn't mean it, but this is how we perceived it, that's when it clicked to him that, you know, it was his inherent bias playing in his mind, tricking in his mind, and that's why he was behaving in that manner, right? So now that we have covered so many examples, I'm very sure that you all can come up with one personal experience. Please share it with your neighbor, and you're more than welcome to come and share it with everybody here.
Just to give a context, I am an Air Force veteran, Indian Air Force, and as you would know that in Air Force or in military as a generally, women are very less, right? So there was a big mindset where they said the fighting force cannot be women. But we have changed over a period of time that women are getting into military forces. But there was one area, especially in Air Force, where they would never allow a woman, which was in fighter pilot. So they think that woman cannot be a fighter pilot because it needs split second decisions like this. So for 50 years probably they have been always arguing about that. And in 2015 we had first three women who got into fighter pilot. And it's very appropriate to say that a couple of weeks ago, Avani Chaudhary, Flying Officer Avani Chaudhary, made a Tibet solo fighter pilot flight just a couple of weeks ago. And I think I'm very proud of the fact that they went for it and she proved that it was done. She did that and she flew a MiG-21 Bison solo, which means nobody was there with her. So she just proved that we wasted 50 years.
That's a great story. We are looking for, again, some personal experiences. We want to get into your head.
A lot of times these are not policies, right? That's the problem. If it was an explicit policy, you could actually, you know, fight it out logically. But when they are not official policy, that's when it becomes extremely hard. All right, so let's take 2 quick minutes. Right, think about a personal example, right, and see if you've been in a situation either on the receiving side or on the giving side where you've experienced something like this. In spirit of inclusion, if you do not want to participate, you're free to sit by yourself, right? Good examples. I think there are 2 people who want to share something. Go ahead, please.
At work, probably one of the things that I thought about is it's mostly about the racism. If we are suggesting something or if we are giving having some idea, sometimes, most of the time, that is not accepted. The same thing, the external party or the foreigner or somebody is told, well, that is accepted. That's probably number one I wanted to share. And that happened in the conference also. I was talking to my manager today. So that's one I just wanted to share.
So what exactly happens when you are at a receiving end of something like this? How does it change your thoughts, and what kind of baggage do you carry with an event like this?
So normally, I probably try to go and be on those places where others won't like to be, and I will probably try to pull the crowd. It could be an argument, it could be a participation, so it could be anything. So that's one of the points that I wanted to make.
So basically what you're saying is you were trying to make a point to your manager at the conference, and the manager did not receive it in a positive spirit or whatever.
It's not in the conference. What I meant to say is
at work. So he or she did not agree with what you had to say.
Exact same point, but if it is told by a foreigner or if it is available on the internet, that it gets a more priority rather than me directly telling them.
So Prachi's question was, when this happened, what was your state of the mind after it happened? Like, does it encourage you to do it again?
Definitely not. So
what is your state of mind?
State of mind, definitely it discourages. At the same time, I live in the same company almost for 12 years. So if plan A is not working, then I will go with plan B. I don't know how others would do. Maybe
okay.
I'll wait to hear from others. Thank you.
All right.
Thanks for sharing that.
Hari?
My general observation has been that the loudest person in the room always gets the authoritative attention, and yeah, I'm not very loud guy, and it usually takes some time to warm up my voice and put some power into it, right? So until then I'm not heard, and then hey, listen to me, and then it happens. So but again, to answer that perspective, which is, what do you do when you're in that situation? Like, it tends to be like, you have to fake that. Even if you're not in my situation, when I'm not really loud, I realize I need to make comments and then put some power into the voice, and then people listen.
Who else wants to come up here?
We're actually hearing a lot of discrimination against men so far.
I would add one more to it. Like, we are a products company, we go to college campuses to hire. When we do recruitment, typically HR team comes along and we would have selected. So we had gone to a campus in Bangalore. We recruited close to 21 people. So the target was, okay, shortlist to 15. So when we had 15 and gave it to the HR, the count was more like 12 boys and 3 girls. Okay, then the HR came back and told to all the panelists, okay, this is not fair. We would need 8 guys and 7 girls. So we said, no, how do you want to do it? We have selected 21 and it's up to you to choose. So we were feeling very bad, even though there was a mixed panel of both boys and girls, ourselves. So it was more of a HR policy, because they were very sensitive about gender inclusion in the company and wanted to, increase the percentage to have a right balance of men and women in the company. And we did not really appreciate each of the panel member, but HR was very rigid about it. They said, you will only realize it after a few years. And so we just had to accept it. So we had 8 boys and 7 girls join the company. We had 15 of them. And after 3 or 4 years, they worked along with us, and we could really feel what HR meant then. We could only understand after 3 years. And then we realized, oh, they had a purpose, and it could clearly mean how a work, especially an organization or a team, when there's a fine balance of men and women in it, it functions altogether very differently compared to only a men's team or only women's team. That we could really relate to.
Not many people can accept or, talk about such things. So thank you for doing that.
I had a similar kind of a baggage, and that I inherited from my ex-boss. And he made a statement, if women are there in the team, then they won't probably perform well, they won't stretch or something like that. I let go that particular baggage probably some 3-4 years ago, and I'm happy to probably share that. The another baggage that we had, having the Muslim community people within the team, I'm happy to say that in a team of 17, there are 6 Muslim community people, and we are happy to do, I mean, probably share that.
That's great.
Sorry? Oh, Moody's Analytics, yeah, okay. Yeah, don't name the boss.
So what I gathered from these two examples was, yes, maybe your initial reaction was governed by your bias or assumptions, and nobody likes quotas and mandates, right? But what I also sense that maybe it was not explained to you, so even there I see a missed opportunity for inclusion, right? So maybe the things could have been explained to you in a better way. There could have been better D&I practices, and it could have been a journey of the whole team or company instead of HR versus employees. So I see a missed opportunity there.
That's a good point. Yeah. All right, let's move to the next one.
Okay, so 5 to 10 minutes more, guys. So now this is going to be a little interesting. We tried to take our biases to within our mind, what is going on in our psyche. Now we want to trace it back to where did it all start, right? Two objectives here, that have we again made something part of our personality because we were taught that way in our school or at home, right? So here, this is actually an exercise, unfortunately, from my school, my son's school, that he got an assignment, and I was wild. But
is,
yes,
this is 2018. This is what kids learn in school.
So you're asking them to choose, and you're obviously enforcing a stereotype there, right? Again, an extreme example. Everybody has heard about this story, I'm sure. So Jesse Penny had released a t-shirt, right? I'm too pretty to do my homework, I'll have my brother do it. Okay, and a kid is wearing that t-shirt. Can you imagine the kind of message that is getting delivered here, right? Okay, we are going to skip the videos, but again, take it back to your upbringing, to your environment, you know, the way you were brought up. And honestly, how do you feel about the messages that you received as a child today as an adult? Any thoughts there? So what are the things that you approve of today, and what you think should have been done differently in your home, in your school?
Read a statistic today that mothers, when talking to their kids, will use numbers more when talking to boy children and to women. And so a lot of the differences that we think might be innate, even mothers are instilling this from a very early age, and I think, what if I had had that? You know, it would have affected perhaps a lot in my life. And I don't think mothers realize they're doing it.
So excellent point there. It again reinforces that belief that, you know, girl child not good at maths, science, technology, and we don't even realize from where we picked that up, right? So it plays on your mind for a long, long time.
I think you will relate to it more because all of us have grown reading fairy tales. Once upon a time, the prince will come and take the princess away. But off late recently, I saw a book which was more of Rebel Girls bedtime story or something. It's more about the ladies who have actually made a mark, and I've been recommending it to many people who have girls and boys both, to read the book instead of fairy tales, because that really gives a different impression. The choice of gifts that we choose for birthdays is very much feminine or masculine, depending on whom we are doing, instead of their interest, what they're interested in. So maybe that's one more choice which people should look into, that just dolls are not just for girls, it can be for boys as well. And that's where we have to make that conscious choice to raise our kids accordingly. And that's what we have been doing with my nephews, nieces, and even the kids around me. That's what I have been doing. And that's where we have to look into it.
That's a brilliant point. In fact, on the fact that you should gift, you should have boys, read Rebel Girls, right? That's the brilliant part, I think, you know, because we, a lot of parents I know will gift the Rebel Girls to girls, but not boys. And I think that is an important point here.
And you actually got us to the next point, which was going to be the concluding point here, that what is that one thing that we can do? What is that one thing, small little step? Again, Linda's words, first step, right? A little small step towards a change. So she already explained that to us. But just one thought here. So we made it clear, this is about inclusion, talked about LGBT, talked about disability. But why do we see so many examples coming from gender and women? It's not about Women's Day. So why do we see that? That's, yes, but correct. But why this men, women, gender thing, why do we have so many common experiences that people share around this? Inequality, right? Okay, so just one piece of statistics that I'm going to share here. So a lot of diversity categories are considered to be a battle between minority and majority, right? Because there are very few LGBT community people, very few people with disability, not really in numbers, but yes, in percentages. So women, this is one category which is not a minority, but still we talk about discrimination against women. And why do these examples come so fresh to our minds? Because we have interactions with opposite sex in every walk of life, at home, at school, at work. So these experiences are more prevalent because this is not a minority category, present everywhere, right? That's one difference that if you may notice.